Hello everyone, I am Be Better Gamer. Welcome to my YouTube channel, Be Better Gamer Wrestling, your place for WWF No Mercy, Virtual Pro Wrestling 2, and WCW nWo Revenge Let's Play episodes, which I am currently doing one right now. I am following up my Cruiserweight Championship Let's Plays with Psychosis, or Psychosis, if you will. Sometimes it's PSI, usually in Mexico or outside of WCW, it was PSI. Sometimes it's PSY, mostly in WCW, it was in PSY. I'm sticking with PSY, that's just because that's how he went by in WCW for most of his time there, especially with his mask on. I'm very excited about this episode. If this is the first time you are watching me, thank you for joining me. Thank you for watching this episode. I hope you enjoy it, and I hope you check out my other Let's Play episodes and all my other various wrestling videos that I have on my channel. But if you're not familiar with what I do here, I do Let's Plays, but I do them a little bit differently. Not only am I going to play through the Cruiserweight Championship path as Psychosis, on the hard difficulty in WCW nWo Revenge, but I'm also going to talk about the historical context of what was going on around the time that WCW nWo Revenge was probably getting developed. And right away I go for a clothesline and I get countered by Billy Kidman, who was actually Cruiserweight champion when the game was released, the only champion in the game that you unlock that actually was champion by the time the game was released. So what's the span I'm looking at? I'm looking at from 1997 to 1998, specifically around Halloween Havoc 97 to Halloween Havoc 98. Now, I'm not only going to talk about what was going on in those months, but I'm going to use that sort of as the focal point to talk about the wrestlers that, you know, I play as. And today I'm playing as Psychosis. And I'm very excited about this episode because Psychosis was always one of my favorites. Very underrated, I feel, in terms of the history of the Cruiserweights. When you think about the Cruiserweights, who do you think about? You think about Kidman. Obviously, you think about Rey Mysterio Jr. D. Malenko's up there in that conversation. You know, most people will probably talk about Juventud Guerrera before they talk about Psychosis, or even maybe La Parca, you know, in terms of how La Parca was so funny and out there and different from all the other Cruiserweights. But I don't think anybody really took Psychosis seriously as being one of the key factors in building up that Cruiserweight division. Yeah, he didn't win a lot, but his rivalry with Rey Mysterio Jr. Before WCW and sort of leading into WCW helped put Rey Mysterio Jr. on the map. Because let's face it, you can only be such a great, you know, wrestler if you're wrestling other great wrestlers, and you know, you're putting them on the map as much as they're putting you on the map. Psychosis was trained by Rey Mysterio Sr., and he was in training camp with Rey Mysterio Jr., and they had a lengthy history even before they got to WCW. So I'm going to talk about that. I'm going to talk about why that's so important, why that's so special, along with the year that it was for Psychosis and how his time in WCW as a Cruiserweight might have been different from other Cruiserweights, and maybe even talk a little bit about, you know, we got Billy Kidman, an American wrestler, and definitely one of the top attractions for the Cruiserweight division. You know, he was doing the Shooting Star Press that he got from Jushin Thunder Liger, just saying. But definitely one of the fan favorites. And I mean, there's a debate to be had because Psychosis was also one of the many Cruiserweights that lost his mask in WCW. He actually didn't lose his mask first in WCW. He actually lost it to Rey Mysterio Sr. Sometime in Mexico before he lost it in WCW. But it was Kidman who defeated Psychosis on an episode of Nitro. And doing so, Psychosis had to take off his mask, much like Rey Mysterio Jr. and much like Juventud Guerrera. Conan has gone on record, Conan the wrestler, not Conan the barbarian. Conan has gone on the record several times saying that it was Eric Bischoff's idea to unmask a lot of the Mexican wrestlers because he felt that none of them can get over if people couldn't see their faces. And I disagree with that heavily. And I think that's also a mentality that even Vince McMahon shares, not necessarily wanting to unmask the Lucha Libre wrestlers that come through wearing masks, but sort of this idea that if they're wearing a mask, they can't get over with the audience, they won't be popular. And obviously Rey Mysterio Jr., you know, destroys that argument, because as soon as he appeared on the scene in WCW, he instantly changed the dynamic of what people expected when they were watching Nitro. But, you know, look at Mexican wrestling in general. Look at Lucha Libre. You wouldn't have big promotions like AAA or CMLL. I mean, you wouldn't even have wrestling in general over there. Half the people who wrestle in Mexico wrestle under mask. And I don't think that's just because of their culture, and that's, you know, the mask represents, you know, old gods and old stories and heroes and, you know, fairy tales and things like that. It's sort of that connection to their culture. I just think that if a wrestler is good, regardless if they're wearing a mask or not, they're going to get over. Look at Jushin Thunder Liger. Jushin Thunder Liger is one of the most famous wrestlers in Japan. He wears a mask. So I think in a way sometimes that helps a wrestler get over, because sometimes having the mask on can give you that character already without maybe necessarily the mic work or, you know, the presentation value. I mean, Psychosis, the one thing I think is underrated about Psychosis is his outfit, his costume. I loved his costume. In WCW NW Revenge, you can edit costumes a little bit. Not too much. It's not like how it is in, you know, later on with WrestleMania 2000 and WWF No Mercy, where you can go full-blown and create your own costumes. But they did have a very simple edit mode where you basically can change the colors. They already had preset costumes you can choose from. And you could give maybe Psychosis, and you can make him look like Alex Wright, who I'm playing as against right now. You can give him his like lower body and stuff like that, so he can wear the Alex Wright tights. But his body is basically Alex Wright. So you'll lose like the Psychosis tattoos that he has. But Psychosis has some really cool outfits, because it always seemed like he was wearing like a suit of armor. He had that one outfit which was like purple, gold, and yellow, and that looked like a battle armor outfit. He had that one outfit where it was half black, half purple, straight down, you know, it was vertical. Even his mask was like cut in half with the colors, almost like how Ultimo Dragon has the red, green, and white half mask that he wears in this game. He had a lot of cool, he had an inverse colors outfit, black and red. That was pretty cool. Here they don't really have that, because his costume, the design of the colors was pretty much in sections, so each section was a different color. Here he just kind of looks like a skeleton. Like, I remember when I first got the game, he didn't look too different from Laparca in terms of how they designed the costume in this game. And maybe just his costume was just a little bit too advanced at this point when they were making this game. But I feel like he's highly underrated in his costume and his mask. And his masks, you know, we were just talking about masks. For the longest time, I thought that was his hair. I thought that big flowing hair that he had. And that's what helped make him stand out to me, is he had this big set of hair overflowing over his mask. And then when he lost his mask to Kidman, he took it off, the hair was actually part of the mask. And I had never seen that before, because I hadn't seen many people get unmasked. You know, I saw Rey Mysterio Jr. get unmasked, but he had a short buzz cut already, and you never really saw his hair overflowing out of his mask. So that was another nifty thing about his costume. Here comes Conan. Speaking of Conan coming in to save the day. Obviously he thinks I need help from Alex Wright. That's the one thing about this championship path in WCW NW Revenge. You never know if a computer is going to come in and make a run in. Not all championship paths have interference on, which is also kind of strange. But the Cruiserweight one definitely does. That doesn't necessarily mean a Cruiserweight is going to come in and run in. Conan is definitely not a Cruiserweight. Conan actually, you know, great that he showed up just in time, because if we're talking about Psychosis, Psychosis made his debut in WCW on an episode, not an episode, I shouldn't say an episode, but he made his first match in WCW was at Clash of the Champions 32, and it was actually against Conan. Conan, who was being billed as the Mexican heavyweight champion, he actually was the AAA heavyweight champion, and they just called it Mexican heavyweight because I guess they didn't want to say it was AAA. Or is it CMLL? I don't remember, actually. It might have been CMLL. I'll have to look that up. I'll have to fact check that when I do my Conan TV title Let's Play. But that was on January 23rd, 1996. That was his first debut in WCW. And then he wouldn't appear in WCW again until July 7th, 1996. Where he debuted at Bash at the Beach, the first pay-per-view he debuted at, against Rey Mysterio Jr. And Rey Mysterio Jr. had made his debut 1 month before. Conan was partly responsible for bringing a lot of the luchadors in, because obviously they were all training together and wrestling together in Mexico, and they formed a strong bond. But before Conan and brought everyone over to WCW, Conan himself, along with all the luchadors, first were brought into the States on a big platform by Paul Heyman in ECW. And Rey Mysterio Jr. and Psychosis, you know, as I mentioned early in the beginning of the video, had a long feud, had a long rivalry in Mexico, and they also fought briefly in Japan. And you know, in other parts of the world, but it wasn't until ECW where we got to see that feud in full effect. And Rey Mysterio's debut ECW match was on a house show that actually got recorded for an episode of Hardcore TV, which you can find on the WWE Network. ECW Hardcore TV episode 127. It's on the WWE Network. Another great benefit of the WWE Network. If you don't have it, highly recommend it. I say it in pretty much every video. You don't have to like the current Raw product or WWE product to get the WWE Network. I mean, I definitely don't get the WWE Network because I love Raw. I get it because I can go back and watch great matches. You also got NXT, a lot of the original documentaries, really good stuff. But go if you have it and you haven't seen Rey Mysterio Jr. versus Psychosis, ECW Hardcore TV 127. Go watch it. And you know, again, that's like the beginnings. And you can tell, you know, ECW fans were known to be like very smart fans. You know, they were ahead of the curve. You know, they were what you would call like smart marks now, you know, smarks, if you will. And usually they were very you know, they knew when a wrestler came from another promotion or from another country, they were already familiar with that wrestler because of tape trading or because of like the wrestling magazines. You know, these were the most hardcore of hardcore fans, not just because of the blood and the weapons and the sex and the violence, but because they watched wrestling from all over the world, and they didn't just watch WWF or NWA, WCW. They watched everything. And when Rey Mysterio Jr. and Psychosis show up, that was really like sort of an invasion, if you will, of the Lucha Libre style into ECW. And at the beginning of the match, you can see the crowd is like kind of like heckling Rey and Psychosis. You got these two guys in the ring, they're wearing these masks, they're wearing these outfits. And as the match is going on, you just see that crowd get hooked. You just see them get hooked. And you can't find better matches between Psychosis and Rey Mysterio Jr., in my opinion, than the ECW matches. I mean, if you're talking about Rey Mysterio versus ECW, I mean, Rey Mysterio Jr. and Psychosis, you have to watch their first match in ECW. You have to watch the follow-up match, which I think is the best of the trifecta of ECW matches they have, because they had three. But the second match was a 2 out of 3 falls, also on the WWE Network. Hardcore TV episode 130, Psychosis, Rey Mysterio, 2 out of 3 falls. Amazing match, still holds up to this day. And then the third match was at November to Remember 95, where it was a Mexican death match, where basically after you scored a pinfall, your opponent had 10 seconds to get up. So it was kind of like a knockout kind of thing, you know? And they also had a tag team match where Rey Mysterio Jr. and Conan took on Psychosis and La Parca. So all these guys were in the ECW briefly, and then Eric Bischoff snapped them up, and you know, the rest is history. Conan kept bringing a lot of the other cruiserweights. I mean, Eddie Guerrero and Dean Malenko were in ECW as well, and they eventually followed suit. And a lot of it was because Conan kept recommending a lot of these guys to Eric, and a whole lot of luchadors came in. You know, Liz Mark Jr. and Silver King and everyone. Everyone was there, and it was great. I feel like Psychosis got kind of lost in the shuffle because, you know, his rivalry with Rey. Obviously, clearly Rey was the breakout star, but Psychosis was kind of like, you know, the shadow to that. And, you know, someone's got to lose to Rey Mysterio Jr. all the time, and it was Rey. But that doesn't, you know, that doesn't make Psychosis any less of a performer, honestly. I mean, he could hold his own with Rey Mysterio, and Psychosis did some great stuff in the ring. I mean, his guillotine leg drop from the top rope, he did it all over the place. He did diving out to the top from the top. He did it, you know, diving onto the apron from the inside, from the outside. But he had one of the most beautiful guillotine lay drops from the top rope. And I'm in the ring with Lodi. And I guess I should talk about, real quick, because I'll get back to Rey. I mean, we could talk about Rey all episode with Psychosis, because there's so much more stuff I want to get into about that. But I'm in the ring with Lodi. Now, there was one guy they didn't have in this game, and that's Lenny Lane. And I guess I should talk about Psychosis actually having the Cruiserweight Championship title, because Lodi and Lenny kind of fit into that, and Lodi's kicking my butt now. And I hate the fact that Lodi's kicking my butt, because I hate the way Lodi looks in this game, because you can't take off his stupid glasses. I think I've mentioned this before in some of my other WCW NW Revenge Cruiserweight Let's Play videos, but you can't take off his glasses, and that bugs me. You know, who wrestles with their glasses on? You can't keep your glasses on when you wrestle. It's just impossible. So, you know, he's got me bloodied and everything. Look at this. This is embarrassing. I'm getting beat up by Lodi. So now I gotta make a comeback. But so Psychosis was only a two-time cruiserweight champion, but he holds the record for having the shortest cruiserweight title reign, if you will. So the first time he won the championship, he defeated Rey Mysterio Jr. Surprise, surprise. On April 19th, 1999. Actually, he didn't defeat Rey Mysterio Jr., you know, by himself. It was a four-way dance. It was him, Rey Mysterio Jr., Juventud Guerrera, and Blitzkrieg. What could have been Blitzkrieg? What could have been? maybe I'll elaborate on that in another episode. But he held the title for 7 days after winning that four-way dance. And he would lose it back to Rey Mysterio Jr. on the following week of Nitro. And that was Rey Mysterio's fifth and final reign in WCW. Obviously, when WWE would revive the Cruiserweight title, Rey Mysterio would get the Cruiserweight title a couple of more times there. But when he beat Psychosis, taking the title off Psychosis, that was Rey's fifth and final reign in WCW. Rey Mysterio would then lose the title to Lenny Lane after holding it for 115 days, and Lane would be stripped of the title after about 46 days due to pressure from TNT executives. So, you know, the actual upper brass of the network didn't want Lenny Lane holding the title, because if you remember Lenny Lane at that time was running this very, you know, hard core, if you will, homosexual gimmick. And the stuff him and Lodi were doing, they were really pushing the envelope, and they didn't like that. You know, WCW brat, you know, executives didn't like that. And so they told them, you know, take the title off of Lenny Lane or else. And they took the title off of Lenny Lane. So the next night after they did that, after they stripped him of the title, they said on the next night on Nitro, Psychosis, he beat him in a house show. Psychosis is the champion now, and now he's gonna defend the title against Disco Inferno. And he lost in his first title defense, never actually winning the title from Lenny Lane. He lost against Disco Inferno, giving Disco Inferno his first Cruiserweight title reign. It's the shortest reign in WCW history, as technically he held it for less than an hour because I believe he lost it in that first hour of Nitro. So that's Psychosis' Cruiserweight Championship accomplishments. So you might ask, oh, why even bother doing a Cruiserweight, championship mode? Well, he was champion, okay? And only two Cruiserweights that are in this game never actually held the championship title. So I'm going to play as all of them. I'm going to play as all the Cruiserweights who held gold. And Psychosis is one of them. And like I said, he was definitely, I feel like, underrated. And I want to talk about, go ahead and watch those ECW matches. And go and watch, I got Ultimo Dragon in the ring. And if you watch my channel and you see my profile pic, I'm a big Ultimo Dragon fan. I probably have more Ultimo Dragon videos up than anyone else at this point. And there will be more to come because I love Ultimo Dragon so much. They actually have a little bit of history. They didn't fight too much around the world like how Psychosis and Rey did. But in WCW, Ultimo Dragon was with Sonny Ono. And when Psychosis came in, it seemed like they wanted to maybe try to push him as like sort of like a counter baby phase. But you had Rey, you had Hoovy, Kidman was coming up. So they shifted gears. And Psychosis actually started feuding with Ultimo Dragon when Ultimo Dragon's manager, Sonny Ono, was done with him. He didn't want any more. He thought Ultimo Dragon wasn't, doing as well as he could. So he decided to drop him for Psychosis. And Ultimo Dragon and Psychosis had a bunch of matches while Ultimo Dragon was with Sonny Ono. But eventually, Ono dropped them, started backing Psychosis, and that was his man. That was his new, way to championship victory or path or whatever. And the whole time Psychosis and Ultimo Dragon feuded, Psychosis actually never beat Ultimo Dragon in a straight-up match, which I think is pretty cool because it's Ultimo Dragon. But another match I want to recommend, and I recommended it in my Ultimo Dragon Cruiserweight Championship Let's Play, is Great American Bash 97. WWE Network, go watch it. Great American Bash 97, first match, Ultimo Dragon against Psychosis. And the reason why I want to mention this is because, again, I think Psychosis was very underrated, especially underrated as a heel cruiserweight, all right? There wasn't a lot of those that really, had a presence to them. And Psychosis definitely had that with his look. I mean, he was kind of taller than a lot of the other cruiserweights, so he always seemed extra tall. Like, he's 5'10", and Rey Mysterio's like 5'6", supposedly, on a good day. And when Psychosis wrestled Rey, he looked like a giant. He looked like he should have just, it's like Kevin Nash wrestling Rey. That's what it felt like. And that's what it felt like when Psychosis wrestled a lot of the other cruiserweights. 5'10 is actually, not that tall. I mean, it's like Jericho's height and stuff like that. But with that mask and his lanky body, he just appeared taller. So he had a great look to him for being a heel, because he could overpower, if you will, because of his size, the other, cruiserweights. And he's working heel in that match, and the crowd is so into Ultimo Dragon, because Ultimo Dragon's been around, like I mentioned in my video, he doesn't stay too long in WCW, but by that time, the fans were ready to embrace him as a babyface. How can you not like Ultimo Dragon? And the crowd was so into that match. It's so good, but the match itself is great. It starts off kind of slow, a lot of mind games, which is cool. I like that. And then the pace starts picking up, and again, it gives Psychosis the time to shine, and he's doing a lot of top rope dives and planchas, and he's doing his guillotine lay drop to the outside. They're working tremendously hard and giving a great entertaining match. So go watch that Great American Bash 97. I'm facing Chris Benoit. I couldn't find a Chris Benoit Psychosis match, but I wouldn't be surprised if they cross paths. At that time, Chris Benoit was having a pretty good year that year. But I guess, we should talk about, what else Psychosis was doing that year. So I like to, go back to Halloween Havoc 97 through 98. He didn't make a lot of pay-per-view appearances. And again, I feel like he should have been. That Great American Bash 97 match between him and Ultimo Dragon was fantastic. And you know, and a lot of things they did with a lot of these cruiserweights, since a lot of them came from Mexico, so they wrestled Lucha Libre style. They did a lot of their trios matches, which is the 6-on-6. So you saw La Parca in a few of those, like 6-on-6, 8-on-8 throughout the year. At Bash of the Beach 97, you know, it was La Parca, Psychosis, and Villano 4 against Juventud Guerrera, Hector Garza, and Lismark Jr. Sold Out 98, Juvi again with Super Calo, Lismark Jr., and Chavo Guerrero Jr. against La Parca, Psychosis, Silver King, and El Dandy. Spring Stampede 98, Psychosis took on La Parca because they were having differences, even, you know, because even though they teamed up a lot of the time, so they were having kind of like a little bit of a fallout. He appeared against Slamboree 98 in that Cruiserweight Battle Royal to fight Jericho, and Ciclope won, but it wasn't really Ciclope, it was Dean Malenko. That was really cool. And then Road Wild 98, Rey Mysterio Jr. took on Psychosis in a singles match for the number one contendership for the WCW Cruiserweight title, which at that pay-per-view, Jericho had it, but Jericho would actually go and lose it to Juvi that night. So again, not a lot of pay-per-view appearances for Psychosis, but you can find a lot of his matches were on Nitro. And you know, it's interesting because that one, you know, it gets kind of bookended in a way. You know, he debuted, his pay-per-view debut was against Rey Mysterio Jr. at Bash at the Beach, and go watch that one. I mean, that was probably their best encounter in WCW, you know, one-on-one. Rey Mysterio Jr., Psychosis, Bash at the Beach, 96. You know, the infamous Bash at the Beach 96 when the nWo appeared. And they tear the house down. I mean, that was a fantastic match between them. Very reminiscent of their ECW matches. Very reminiscent of their match at the Super J Cup in 95, I believe. Their 95 Super J Cup, they had an exhibition match there. They weren't actually part of the J Cup. They were just invited to wrestle each other. Astounding match there too. And that Bash at the Beach 96 was more of that. You know, the Road Wild 98 match, I don't know what was going on there. It was one of their more weaker matches. You know, it was, Psychosis was working the ground game hard in that. And Rey Mysterio, you know, he eventually does take to the skies and does a lot of dives, but not nearly as much as you know, we knew him for. I mean, it's only 2 years from Bash at the Beach 96, so who's wondering, you know, who knows what was going on in that match. It just seemed different. The dynamic that they usually have was very different in that match, so who knows what was going on there. But you know, you can find, there's an episode of Nitro on the WWE Network, Nitro 79, March 17th, 1997, where Rey Mysterio Jr. and Psychosis fight. Great match. Fantastic match. You know, another out of the nowhere classic on Nitro. And that was what was so great about, you know, WCW, is that a lot of the time they opened the shows, or at least in the first hour, you got to see the cruiserweights go at it. And you'd be lucky, you know, if you got two or three cruiserweight matches in one night. And Psychosis was always around. I mean, he was always taking the loss. You know, he was always losing to guys like Rey and Juvi and Kidman, Ultimo Dragon. But you know, he was still there. And honestly, out of all the heels, in my opinion, if you're not counting Eddie Guerrero, because I don't really consider Eddie Guerrero as like a cruiserweight in his time in WCW, even though they wanted to pigeonhole him as that. He definitely feuded with a lot of the cruiserweights, and he started LWO with a lot of the cruiserweights. I still considered him in another category. And obviously, when he would finally break away from WCW and go to WWE, you know, he was able to realize that, and we were all able to see that, you know, him live out his potential. But Psychosis was the top, in my opinion, the top Rudo, you know, the top heel of all the, you know, stars from Mexico, all the Lucha Libre wrestlers, all the cruiserweights. I always felt like Psychosis was a top heel, even though he wasn't winning. Again, he just had that arrogance to him, that cockiness to him, you know, that look. I mean, the look he had with the hair and you know, I love Psychosis. I can't talk about it enough, but there's Benoit's giving me a little bit of trouble in this match. There I go, I'm going to the side, bam. You know, usually Psychosis would actually do that twisting senton to the opponent when they're on the floor. Never really saw him do much of it unless he was diving to the outside. They gave him that twisting senton to the outside, which is pretty cool, giving him the Mexican surfboard, which is one of the few submission moves, I should say, in this game that actually builds up your meter while you do it. And there I go, I'm gonna grab. Juan's proven to be a little bit tricky, he's ducking all my grabs. And there I go for the back special, because this should put him away, and it does. So there you go, Benoit, goodbye. You know, a lot of the cruiserweights have similar moves in this game, only because, again, I think it's because, you know, they all wrestle the similar style, and what really defined them was their look. I mean, you know, they all had their signature thing. Psychosis had the leg drop. Rey Mysterio had, like, you know, all his million different ways he could hit you with the Hurricanrana. Kidman had the Shooting Star Press. Ultimo Dragon had, like, the Liger Bomb and the Dragon Sleeper. Jericho had, you know, the Lion Tamer. But they all wrestle a similar style, and it's not like they couldn't do what the others could do. And I think that's what was so fun about watching the trios matches and the 8-on-8s that Psychosis was a part of. I mean, there's a lot of them. A really good one, I would recommend, you know, the Bash at the Beach 97 one is fun. Juventud Guerrera, Hector Garza, and Liz Mark Jr., against La Parca, Psychosis, and Villano. But there's actually one that Psychosis actually ends up in a rare victory for Psychosis. Psychosis actually ends up getting the pinfall on an episode of Nitro. Let me see if I can find it. Is it Nitro? I wrote it in my notes, and now I'm having trouble finding it. It was with the Villanos. Give me one brief moment while I scroll through my notes. Can't find. Oh, here it is. It was Clash at the Champions. Okay, Clash at the Champions 35, August 21st, 1997. You can find it on the WWE Network. Psychosis, Silver King, Villano 4, Villano 5, against Juventud Guerrera, Super Calo, Hector Garza, and Liz Mark Jr. That was a really fun match. That's a really great, entertaining match. And the crowd gets pretty into it. And again, these are guys, like, you know, never, these guys were never stars, and they never rose to the heights in WCW where they can be considered to be going up against the outsiders. And, you know, they kind of treated a lot of those luchadors and you know, mask wrestlers kind of like as jokes. And but you go and you watch those trios matches, you go and you watch those 4-on-4 matches, you know, those 8-man tags, and this is what they do in Mexico all the time. And obviously it's super popular in Mexico because that's their style, the Lucha Libre style. But there's a, you know, there's a, I guess, what should I say? There's sort of like a whole nother skill set that they're wrestling on that I feel like American audiences love, but they've been deprived of. You know what I mean? Like, if you look at how WWE does their, when they do their six-man tags at the end of Raws, you know, they do it just so they can fit in all their stars, and the stars can, you know, get their special moves, and it could move forward, you know, a feud between, you know, one guy and the other. And the other guys were just there as just sort of, you know, so you have a lot of stars on Raw so people won't get disappointed. Like, honestly, that's really the formula for the six. There's no really rhyme or reason for them to have. In Lucha Libre, there's a lot of teamwork going on, and there's a lot of different creative ways in how they work the match and the pacing of the match, and the fact that you don't have to tag in and tag out. It's fast, everyone's moving boom, 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 spot, 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 you know, dive out the top row. And then you have that one moment where everyone just keeps diving on each other. But it's not the same. These guys, they all can do it. But they, not every single match is the same when they do it. And every guy kind of like takes turns. All right, now, you know, Silver King's going to be the one who dives outside, or, you know, Psychosis is going to be the one who does the, you know, backflip outside. Like they all switch. And I think that's why in WCW NWO Revenge, a lot of the cruiserweights, especially the Mexican wrestlers, they have a similar move set between each other. It's because they all could do the same thing. You know, as amazing as Rey was and as innovative as he was, there wasn't too much that he could do that you didn't see Hoovy doing, that you didn't see Psychosis doing. And I think that's what made it always so exciting, especially when you got like eight of them in the ring, and especially with their body types. I mean, again, Psychosis was, you know, the giant out of all of them. And he definitely stood out in those matches, you know, standing over everyone. But you look at guys like the Vianos. I mean, the Vianos didn't look like guys who could dive off the top rope, you know, or over the rope, I should say. And they could. You know, Silver King didn't look like a guy who could move as fast as he did. And he moved, you know, he could keep up with Juventud Guerrera and the best of them. You know, Lismark Jr., he was very muscular. And again, didn't look like a guy who should be diving and doing backflips and front flips. And he could. And, you know, that's just, I don't know, it's just in their blood, I guess. Like, the fact that they can all do these flips and these rolls and these tumbles and just, you know, nonstop, you know. And I guess, you know, there's always arguments that, well, you know, it's not as realistic in terms of like the selling, you know, they're never selling. It's just spot after spot after spot. But you look at what fans in America gravitate towards too, and a lot of them, you know, going back to ECW, there wasn't a whole lot of selling going on in ECW. It was spot after spot after spot. And the fans ate it up. And the Attitude Era, I mean, the Attitude Era, you know, there was a lot of quick, you know, fast-paced matches going on. And then when the Hardy Boys got on, you know, came up, and, you know, Edge and Christian, and just, you had all these dramatic and intense spots with weapons. And but all the matches, if you go back and you watch, all the matches had a very fast pace to them. All the storylines had a fast pace. It was always like, it always seemed like, you know, they were in a rush when they were doing Raw. It's like JR would come out screaming at the top of his lungs, "Welcome everyone to Monday Night Raw. We're about to start Raw." You know, like it was always that kind of frenetic energy, which you find in the, you know, the trios matches and the 4-on-4 matches with all the, you know, Lucha Libre wrestlers, with all the mask wrestlers. And, you know, Psychosis was very much, you know, one of those instrumental parts, because again, he was that, you know, probably the top heel out of all of them. But I do feel he still was able to stand out in those matches because he had the most personality. And you look at when he was finally unmasked, and I don't know, people didn't respond to him as much as they responded to, say, Rey Mysterio Jr. when he lost his mask. But Rey Mysterio Jr., when he lost his mask, he was already on another level in other people's eyes. You know what I mean? You couldn't really take that away from him. People already connected to him because of his size, because of his spirit, you know, because of his creativity in the ring. And removing his mask wasn't really gonna hurt him. It made him look like a child because he looked so young and baby-faced. But, you know, when Juventud took off his mask, I feel like fans empathized him with him a little bit. But when Psychosis took off his mask, it didn't really help. Psychosis, he didn't look as intimidating without his mask. He didn't look like that heel that, you know, he was with all the other cruiserweights. There was just something about him losing his mask that was just different from, you know, when Rey lost it. He never really recaptured it, but he kept it off. He kept it off. And actually, once WCW folded, he went back to ECW and he wrestled without his mask, which is something completely opposite from what Rey did. You know, when WCW folded, Rey went back to wearing his mask. He was like, screw this. You know, I'm going to go back to wearing my mask. These guys can't stop me. You know, they don't, you know, I lost my mask in WCW, but let's act like it never happened. And I think Rey was better for it, honestly, that he went down that path. And when he came back to WWE, he came back with his mask, because all of these guys shouldn't have lost their mask in the first place because of Eric Bischoff's mentality. Oh, they're not going to get over. I think, you know, I mean, there was a lot of problems with WCW, and obviously we can't go back and fix it. But I think Psychosis losing his mask definitely didn't help in terms of establishing him as a heel, especially a top heel that can rise beyond the cruiserweight division, beyond just being another one of the Mexican wrestlers that a lot of people probably just viewed him as. And you could also contribute that to the fact that beyond, you know, at least here in the States, beyond like, oh, if he loses his mask, like that's like the biggest storyline they can get. That's why it was, you know, it's very disappointing to see when you look back at like Eddie Guerrero, he's tried to start the LWO, which Psychosis ended up joining. There was so much potential in making that faction actually mean something, but you know, you had the NWO and that wasn't gonna get over the way it should have gotten over. And it really is compelling, you know, the plight of the Mexican wrestlers, the plight of these wrestlers who are superstars and legends over in Mexico, but when they come over here, you know, they're just another one of the mask wrestlers. And you look at Psychosis and La Parca. Psychosis and La Parca, you know, they could have been a great heel tag team. You know, I would have loved to see them actually go after the tag team titles. You know, how cool would that have been? You know, and La Parca too. La Parca is one of those cruiserweights who had a bigger body type, had a bigger size than a lot of the other cruiserweights, and that allowed him to establish himself as a heel. You know, yeah, he was doing the dancingness and stuff, but you know, that, you know, you could also say that that was part of his arrogance and cockiness too, that he didn't take his opponent seriously in the ring, and he would embarrass them by dancing, you know, in front of them. In that ECW match between Psychosis, La Parca against Conan and Rey, you know, there's a moment where La Parca, you know, catches Rey Mysterio and he starts dancing while holding Rey Mysterio, because Rey Mysterio is so small, you know, it's like a little joke to La Parca, the chairman of the board. Which, come on, like, who isn't a threat if they're coming to, you know, the ring with a chair? La Parca never held the WCW Cruiserweight Championship, so unfortunately, I won't be doing a Cruiserweight run with La Parca anytime soon, but maybe I'll do a bonus run at the end when I'm finished all my WCW Championship Let's Plays. So yeah, you know, Psychosis and La Parca fought. They actually fought in the year that we're talking about, you know, previously. Spring Stampede 98, they fought, and it was an okay match. I mean, they're better as a team. It was always weird to see those things where they were actually trying to develop, you know, these cruiserweights and have them have stories within themselves, separate of the, you know, major plot lines with the NWO and this and that. But it never really felt like it was going to go anywhere. And it's not like this ended their relationship in WCW. La Parca and Psychosis would team many times. Speaking of a time, you know, it wasn't actually La Parca, but there's a tag team match with Juventud Guerrero and Rey Mysterio Jr., where they take on La Parca and Psychosis. It's on an episode of Nitro. Nitro 118 on December 15th, 1997. Go and watch this match. This is a great match. This is a great out of nowhere tag team match between the four of them. And, you know, no rhyme or reason. It's just them. It's just Juvi and Rey taking on La Parca and Psychosis, giving everyone another excellent showcase of the cruiserweights. And it's fantastic. The crowd eats it up as usual. La Parca and Psychosis are great heels. Juvi and Rey, they do their thing. And it's fantastic. It's fantastic to watch. There's another match I want to talk about real quick. Even though it's not necessarily in the timeline, but it has to do with the Cruiserweight Championship. So Psychosis ended up challenging for the title of total of 11 times and only officially winning it once. And he did challenge it at one point in another four-way dance, sold out 99. Billy Kidman, Rey Mysterio Jr., Psychosis, and Juventud Guerrera all fighting for the Cruiserweight Championship. Billy Kidman was the champion. And, you know, this was sold out 99, so 99 wasn't the best year for WCW. 99 and 2000 weren't great years. The fans are just so dead in this match, and they are going all out. You know, this is Rey post-injury Rey, so Rey isn't doing as much of his crazy flips and, you know, hurricanranas as we're accustomed to. You know, that's the unfortunate thing about Rey Mysterio's career, is that, you know, because of injuries, you know, a lot of his style, you know, was hampered by it. You know, obviously, because you hurt your knees after a while, you can't do all those flips and everything like he used to. It's bound to happen. So, you know, later Rey isn't as exciting sometimes to watch. I mean, he still has great ability in the ring, but he's definitely not as dynamic as he was a few years prior. But it's still a fantastic match between the four of them. And Psychosis is busting his ass in that match, along with Kidman and Hoovy. The crowd only ever seems to come alive when Kidman does something, which is, I don't know if it's telling of how audiences just, you know, associate themselves when they see the three Mexican wrestlers and one American wrestler in the ring, if they just want to gravitate towards the American wrestler, like, oh, he's got to be the good guy, right? You know, like, or if they just, you know, Kidman just was the, you know, person that crowd was more accustomed to, and they really, you know, he came in as the champion, so they wanted to see him leave as the champion. So I don't know, very weird, just because that match is such a great match. If you watch it with the sound off, you're like, oh, the crowd's probably like losing their minds. But if you watch it with the sound on, completely different match. So that's interesting. I don't know, I thought I'd just bring that up. So I beat, who did I just beat? That was La Parca. I beat La Parca, and now I'm going to be facing, coming up, Disco Inferno, who I mentioned at the beginning, defeated Psychosis. Psychosis, you know, becoming the Cruiserweight champion because the title was stripped off of Lenny Lane, giving him the honor of being the shortest reigning Cruiserweight champion. But also, I should also bring up that there was another situation when Psychosis lost the title that he didn't actually win, and that was when they did the horrible, horrible thing of inviting Jushin Thunder Liger to WCW when Jushin Thunder Liger had the IWGP Junior Heavyweight Championship, which is the major Junior Heavyweight Championship from New Japan Pro Wrestling. On the episode of Nitro on November 29th, 1999, and Juventud Guerrera beat Liger. I was so upset about this when I saw it. Juventud Guerrera beat Liger by smashing a bottle over his head. You know, and Psychosis was helping, trying to interfere, and they distracted him. Or I think he distracted the ref so that Juve can hit him with the bottle. And Liger lost the title. On the following week, when Liger was challenging back for the championship, he was supposed to face Juve, who was the new IWGP Junior Heavyweight Champion. But Hoovy got a DUI and couldn't show up to the event. So Psychosis had to take his place, and Psychosis defended the IWGP Junior Heavyweight Championship that Juventud Guerrera won. And obviously Psychosis lost, Liger won the title and went back to New Japan. And wouldn't return to WCW after that. So Psychosis has the honor, if you will, of being the only wrestler to ever lose two titles that he never won, which I don't know if is something he brags about to this day. It probably isn't. Poor Psychosis. It's just things like that. Like, looking back at Psychosis, really the only thing, and I'm sure he's fine with his career. You know, I hate trying to speak on behalf of these wrestlers, because these wrestlers are living out their dreams, and I'm sure, you know, they've achieved success in their own way, and that's well and fine. But you know, when you're a fan, you always like want to see your favorites achieve more than they did, you know, and you're never satisfied unless you see them achieve all that. So you always feel, I don't know, maybe it's just me, but I always feel like when I see a guy like Psychosis, I'm like, ah, he could have done so much more. There could have been so much more, you know, to do with him. But I'm sure he's fine. He's happy with his life. He's living it up. He still wrestles. You know, he, after WCW folded, he went back to ECW for a little bit. Would wrestle around, you know, in Mexico, obviously, and around the world. And then when ECW, or actually WWE, did the ECW One Night Stand pay-per-view, they actually had Rey Mysterio Jr. against Psychosis, which I thought was really cool. Was a really cool nod to, you know, it was such a specific time in ECW's history. It was only a few months where those guys came in and tore up the joint, but it was so memorable because it was, again, that, you know, beginning exposure to Lucha Libre wrestling in, you know, the US. I mean, it had been around for, you know, American fans knew of it. You know, in the West territories, you had, you know, the Guerreros feuding with Roddy Piper, and you know, you had a lot of, you know, you had Mil Máscaras wrestling around in the NWA territories. You had a lot of, you know, it wasn't like Lucha Libre was unheard of, but I don't know, there was just something, I guess there was just something about ECW and its style and how easily Rey Mysterio and Psychosis were able to translate that there, and fans just gravitated to it at a whole nother level than maybe when, you know, WCW did the When Worlds Collide, or actually say NWA, when NWA did the When Worlds Collide event, where they had Lucha Libre stars all wrestling on American soil and things, and so, which Psychosis was actually a part of, a very young Psychosis. But it was cool that when they did the ECW pay-per-view, you know, which was really good, they hearkened back to that. And obviously, this was 10 years later. I mean, because this pay-per-view was in 2005, okay? So this was 10 years from when Rey and Psychosis made their debut at ECW. And 10 years is a long time, especially for someone like Rey, who you could tell 10 years later, Rey, after all those knee injuries, and you know, I think he even broke his leg once. They were just different wrestlers. They couldn't do a lot of the stuff they used to, but they went out there and they still, I think, they still put on a good match. And the fans were being kind of, you know, jerkish during that match because they were booing the fact that they weren't maybe doing as many high flying moves as they once did, especially during their match, you know, their original matches in ECW. But like, come on, give these guys a break. You know, Rey Mysterio had knee surgery, and you know, they're older. You do dives and jumps out, you know, from the top rope to the outside, and moonsaults and somersaults. After a while, it's gonna catch up to you, especially for 10 years. And when they made their debut at ECW, they were already wrestling years before that for like 8 years. So can't really expect them to go out there and still wrestle like they did on their first day of training. That was the only thing that kind of bothered me going back and watching it. I guess I didn't remember that part when I first saw it because I was just so excited to see the fact that they had Rey Mysterio Jr. and Psychosis kind of relive that special moment. But yeah, you know, he did that, and then immediately after that he was in WWE, and they did that whole, you know, stupid, in my opinion, Mexicools gimmick with him, super crazy, and Hoovy, and I don't even want to get into that. That's a whole nother episode. But let's just say, you know, I wasn't crazy about that gimmick. But again, it was just more of the same of like, we're not gonna take these, you know, Mexican wrestlers seriously, and we're gonna have them do a joke gimmick. And they try to write it off like they were making a social comment about it, but they weren't, because if they were, then they would actually have them win a bunch of matches and actually make them a formidable trio in their roster, and they never did. I think like their biggest victory was against, like, you know, Little Guido's faction in WWE. You know, he was Nunzio in WWE. But yeah, but after that, he went back to AAA and wrestling around. And he actually had to change his name because AAA, he wrestled back in AAA briefly, but then he left and he started wrestling in other promotions. And AAA actually had a name dispute with him and said they own the rights to Psychosis. You can't use Psychosis anymore. So Psychosis had to change his name to Nicho El Millonero, which is what he wrestles as today. And he actually did have a match with the new Psychosis, who took his name, and ended up being like a squash, really. Like, you know, neither one of them won. Someone else came in and interfered, and then, like, I guess they just gave up on it. So he's still Nicho El Millonero, and, you know, I'm sure he's happy with the success he's has and the fact that he can still go out there and wrestle today. But I guess when I do these Let's Plays and I go back, you know, I'm older now, I'm more knowledgeable with the going on of wrestling, both on camera and behind the scenes, and you hear the stories, you hear the politics, and when you look at guys especially like Psychosis and all the other, you know, Mexican, you know, wrestlers, you gotta know that race played a factor into it. And you look at the state of wrestling today and you're like, well, how much has changed? You know, I mean, you know, we don't have many Mexican stars, let alone even Mexican-American stars in WWE. You know, we got Alberto Del Rio, who just came back after being fired or let go or quitting, however you want to, you know, take the story, because WWE, you know, employee made a racist remark and Alberto Del Rio hit him because of it. So they let Alberto Del Rio go, but they kept the guy. That doesn't make any sense. Rey Mysterio Jr. is no longer with WWE. He's going to Lucha Underground now, which is great. Kalisto is a Mexican-American wrestler, which is awesome. But one of the, first ones for them to really bring in since Rey Mysterio Jr. And he's wrestling with Sin Cara, who's posing as a Mexican. And, you know, the Los Matadores, they're Puerto Ricans, they're from the Colon family, so there's not a whole lot, you know, there's only a very small amount. And, you know, you look at Lucha Underground, you look at what Lucha Underground's doing, and I think it's fantastic what they're doing. They're not only bringing over the Lucha Libre style, but they're sort of adapting it. And they're not even adapting it. They're just making it their own, so that when you watch Lucha Underground, you know that this is Lucha Underground. It's not WWE. It's not the Cruiserweights from WCW. You know, it's not Lucha Libre specifically. It's its own thing. It's its own world. And they take all different styles and they mold it together. And you're able to have other, you know, wrestlers who aren't Mexican wrestle along with these Mexican wrestlers. It's not impossible. It's not an impossible idea. And that's what I love. That's what I love to see. And it always makes me wonder if, you know, what could have been? What could have been if they had something like this back in the day? If the, you know, Lucha Libre wrestlers, when they came to WCW, if they were given that extra platform, if they were allowed to mix it up with the big boys, if you will. Here's D Malenko. D Malenko was a champion when I did this Let's Play run. And, Psychosis and D Malenko actually fought for the championship on an episode. Not an episode. At a pay-per-view. They fought at the... let me look it up. It's in my notes. I gotta scroll. This is why I write everything down, because I forget. All right, it was at World War III, 96. D Malenko against Psychosis for the Cruiserweight Championship. I wasn't crazy about that match, only because it was too... Like, I love D Malenko, don't get me wrong. I love D Malenko, but it was too much of a D Malenko match. You know, he was completely just working on body parts for Psychosis, but there was no... Psychosis was outclassed the whole match. You know, like, D Malenko looked like... He didn't want to give Psychosis anything. Psychosis had like one good spot where he leg dropped. He did his guillotine leg drop to D Malenko on the outside, but that's about it. I mean, Psychosis didn't stand a chance in the ring with D Malenko. D Malenko was just kept him on the ground the whole time. wasn't anything as dynamic as when, you know, Dean Malenko had a lot of his championship bouts with Rey Mysterio Jr. But yet, still, I mean, you know, you can. Dean Malenko is not like Dean Malenko couldn't put on a great match. It's just that that just ended up not being one of their, you know, great matches with him and Psychosis. But yeah, I mean, you know, Psychosis, what can I say? What more can I say than I haven't already said about Psychosis? I hope when you watch this episode, you know, it kind of opens your mind to a lot of these masked wrestlers who maybe didn't get their spotlight. And now that we're able to go back and just watch these matches outside of their context, I think you're able to see their talent a lot more. And I think that's another thing I like about the WWE Network, is I can go back and I can watch, you know, someone like Psychosis, and I could just watch his matches and not and have it exist outside of, you know, the bubble that it was trapped under when it was in WCW. You know, I can watch it outside of the fact that, oh, he was never going to get, you know, a U.S. heavyweight title shot or, you know, world heavyweight title shot or anything like that. He was going to be involved in a big storyline with the nWo or anything like that. And sometimes that actually happens, you know, the other way too. I'll go back and I'll watch big events. You know, I recently did my Survivor Series 1998 matches, you know, from the Deadly Game tournament. And I thought I remembered this Deadly Game tournament as being this awesome tournament to decide the WWE champion. And then when I went back and actually watched the thing, I was like, wow, this, a lot of these matches aren't really all that good, and they all end in DQ, you know? And I was like, oh, this wasn't as exciting as I thought it was, as I thought I remembered it to be. So that's one of the great things about the network, and I hope by, you know, watching my Let's Plays, you go back and you do that yourself. So again, go back, watch Rey Mysterio Jr., Psychosis, all the ECW stuff. They got three matches. The second one's the best one, in my opinion. But, you know, you could choose your favorites. 1996, Bash at the Beach against Rey Mysterio. And, yeah, I'm going to keep going. I'm going to keep, you know, moving on in this Cruiserweight Championship Let's Play series. So I hope you like, you know, give me a big thumbs up if you did. Leave a comment, subscribe, all that jazz. And until next time, keep watching wrestling. Thank you.